What is up, YouTube and all my fish keeping friends? How is everybody doing out there in fish tank land? Today we're gonna take a look at my nano blue tetras. I have hundreds of fry and I need to move them into a new fry tank. Don't go anywhere. So a lot of you probably already know that I have some nano blue tetras. It's a Tetracharyx tambopatensis. Comes from the Madre de Dios River Basin in southern Peru. Now in 2018, I was there with, you know, Go Wild Peru, Michael Barber. There was, you know, Dean Tweedell, Dwayne Kitchell, Corey, and I were all there and collecting fish. And I came back with, in the end, I came back with 16 of these blue tetras. And now I have 4 tanks. I wanna go ahead and move all of the fry into their own tanks so that I can let them grow out a little bit more, feed them a little bit more, and actually do a lot more water changes in that tank as well. So we're looking at my blue tetra tanks here in the kitchen, and you have the original tank right here in the center. Started out with 16 fish, brought them back about 1.5 years ago or so. And then they started to breed in here. The female started to lay their eggs up under the duckweed. And I eventually had a whole bunch of fish in here, about 40 or 50 or so. And then I took a group of them and I added them, put them into this tank. And they started to breed in here as well. And then I moved the majority of them over to this to make my third tank and left 4 behind. And those 4 in here have created this huge colony of fish. A lot of them are hiding in the dark in the background because I'm standing here in front of the tank like this. But there is literally about 150, 200 fish just in this tank alone. The same thing with the original tank here. So I wanna go ahead and pull out as much of the fry out of this tank and out of this tank, leaving 2 nice groups, breeding groups behind. And I'm gonna put all of the fry down into this tank right here. Which has been, you know, cycling. There is a bunch of mosquito larvae in here, and I'm not happy about that because those mosquitoes will end up biting me while I'm sleeping. So I'd like to get some fish in here as soon as possible so they can eat those mosquito larvae. I do have another group in here. I have 1 male and 3 females, and I wanted to see that, you know, just test that out and see what happens with that. So far, I do not have any fry. I don't have any breeding happening in this tank, and same with this tank right now. So I have 2 tanks that I'm waiting to see some activity in. I have the 2 original tanks, and we're gonna make a 5th tank here and get these guys quarantined as well. I'd like to get all of the fry that I have in these 2 tanks quarantined, because I do want to bring some back to the States soon. So I needed to get them, go through a course of medications just to make sure that they're healthy and happy for flight. Now, like I've mentioned before, this fish is on the CARES list. It is listed as a least concern, but that was as of like 2005, I believe. This fish and the location where we collect it specifically, the location is definitely very, very threatened by mercury poisoning and things like that. I know for a fact because I saw it myself. Unless somebody runs and grabs some right now, I don't know how many more of these fish from this location are going to be available. And with that being said, I am really grateful to have some of them, and I want to make sure that I can share them with the rest of the hobby. I don't want to waste too much more time. I want to go ahead and collect up these fry out of these 2 tanks here. So it was actually a couple of days later. I'm wearing something different. I just really wanted to go ahead and give these fish just a moment to get comfortable and relax so that I can go ahead and feed them. So to start off, we have the 2 original tanks here. We have the first tank, tank number 1. You can see that I did leave a lot of fry in here. A few anyways. There's definitely fry up at the surface, little microscopic fry that you can see just hanging out. Those aren't really microscopic ones, but there's a few. really, really small fry hanging out at the top. But I wanted to leave a little bit of fish in here. I wanted to go ahead and give this tank a chance to have the hormones I believe it needs to have in there from having smaller fish in there to just get the adult fish breeding again. This original tank has been set up and running for almost 2 years now. I don't know, we're getting there. And then this tank here is, I don't know, about 7 months old, maybe a little bit longer than that. And as I told you guys before, I started out with 4 fish in here. I went ahead and removed as many of the fry as I could from the top. There's still a whole bunch of little fry up here at the top of the water, at the surface. You might be able to see some up there. There's a few lingering around. And I have noticed some new, really, really small fry that are probably only a couple of days old. And so we'll see what's happening in here, but there's actually, I believe, 3 females and 2 males in here right now, which I think is a really nice ratio for these fish. And you guys can see what I'm doing at the top, like I was showing before. I've got this fence up here. Obviously, it looks like I need to clean it. You know, the sponge filter's sticking up out of the water. You know, I like to leave these guys alone and just let it get a little crazy and wild, because then they're comfortable. I don't put my hands in these tanks very often at all. And so, I am gonna do a little bit of a top off and get it really close to the top of the line of this this little gate that I've made, just to kind of keep the duckweed on the backside here and leave this little bit of surface area. That surface area really is helpful. Helps keep the harkari, the powdered fish food, floating on the surface area. And it gives the little fry a place to feed as well, obviously. Now the third tank here, this is what I'm really excited about that I wanted to share with you guys right now. As I was checking out the last couple of days since I moved all of the fry, and there's little fry in this tank. So tank number 3, Tetra breeding tank 3.0, does have some fry up there at the surface. And I don't think you're gonna see them. Maybe we'll get lucky and see one or two up in these corners. But I have definitely seen at least 3 or 4 at the same time in here. So I'm really excited to have successfully created a third tank and have gotten these guys to breed for me for a third time in a third tank. It's just really exciting, and I really look forward to being able to share these guys. So I've got a whole bunch of fry that I've collected in this new 10-gallon aquarium, and I have a new batch of baby brine shrimp that I just hatched as well. So let's go ahead and check out all of these new Tetra fry, and let's feed them some live baby brine shrimp. It looks like they did not enjoy those live baby brine shrimp at all. Not at all. There's none left, really. There's a couple lingering. But please keep in mind, there are a lot of fry in this tank. There's a lot more than I'm really showing you with the camera right now. At the surface of the water here, there's a whole bunch of little microscopic ones. I mean, there really are like 2-3 day old. 4 or 5 day old fry in here as well that I collected with the net that were hanging at the surface and in the duckweed that got that was brought into this tank. So I can't just feed live baby brine shrimp to this tank. I have to feed all three of the foods that I feed. Something else that I really like to feed to these nano blue tetras is microworms. So I'm just gonna go ahead and add a little bit of these microworms to the water, mix it around, get it all stirred around, get them everywhere, all over the place. And this is gonna be really good food for the, you know, 2-3 day old fry, 1 week old, 2 week old fry. Well, they're all gonna eat this stuff, but I'm saying that, you know, there's fry in here that can't eat anything bigger than these microworms, and the baby microworms that were just put in here and whatnot. So all of these little microscopic fry are gonna have a nice little meal now of their own. You can see everything floating around in the water. All the microworms and the live baby brine shrimp. This is all just really awesome food for all of these fry. They're having a ball. They're super happy. So I like to go ahead and wait a little while and let all of these fry eat the food that I put in here right now. And then in about an hour or so, I'm gonna go ahead and add some first bites, some Hikari first bites. It's just a powdered fish food. I'm gonna sprinkle that on the surface tension of the water here. And that's something that they can graze on for the next, few hours, 3 or 4 hours. Besides those fry, I do have this fourth tank that I'm trying to breed tetras in, and I haven't had any fry yet. And one of my theories here, and something that a lot of other people do as well, there are a lot of people out there that follow the theory of using the hormones from other fry and from other breeding tanks to seed other tanks and stimulate breeding and spawning in those tanks. So I kind of want to do that test with this tank. I want to go ahead and give this tank about a week without water changes, and I'm going to go ahead and pull out, you know, about 3 or 4 gallons of water, maybe 5 gallons out of this tank. And I'm going to top this tank off with it. In order for it to work, I think that, you know, within a week I should see some fry, some little microscopic fry on the glass and stuff like that. If it's actually working, I don't know. But we're gonna go ahead and try that out and just see what happens. Now, besides the tetras, there's a few other things going on in the fish room that I need to tell you guys about. I'm getting a little excited about the blue bolts. I did some treatments with hydrogen peroxide and they are looking a lot better and they're a lot more active. So I think that actually is helping. I do have some unfortunate news. I did try to spawn the killifish one more time and the female did kill one of my males, which is really unfortunate. I definitely have to make a video about that and explain how that happened, what went down, and, you know, the learning experience that I gained from that. And there's definitely something to be learned from that. So I'll definitely make a video about that. These guys are doing good after a little bit of a hydrogen peroxide treatment for a little bit of the hair algae that popped up. I was planning for stuff like that to happen, but the Sterogenes ripens is doing good, growing out of the water, and the Hygrophila angustifolia is still pretty happy growing out of the water. So like I said, the blue bolts are a little bit happier and more active. You can see they're out and about. I really love these shrimp and I look forward to getting them breeding again. I'm at a crazy angle on this tank, so it's not gonna focus properly. But those guys are a lot more active than they were before. And I'm just looking forward to seeing some of the females become buried. And that's when I'm really gonna get excited. In this 5 gallon bucket here, I have some guppies that I collected, a video I made just a couple of days ago or so. I'll put a card above for that. These guppies are guppies that I put into a pond, a while ago, and I'm bringing them back into the house, but they're going through a pretty rigorous quarantine process before they touch anything else in my house. I will be making a video about that as well, just kind of explaining the full process of quarantining and bringing crazy stuff in the house from out in the wild. Everybody in the living room is doing good, that's for sure. This tank here is doing good as well. I'm not so happy with the Anubias, but we're gonna see what's going on with that. Might have to take a little bit of a different direction with that tank, but we'll get into that in the future. Elliot is looking happy in here for the most part, but he was stressed by the new scaping, and he's not eating. Eels will do that, and it looks like it's probably gonna be a couple of weeks or a month before he wants to eat again, and it is something that they have a tendency to do, just kind of like snakes will do that as well sometimes. Everybody else is doing good. The bacteria bloom doesn't seem to ever want to go away. That's something that it would be such a dreamy thing to just get rid of it without having to break that tank down. And everybody else is doing good down here. Of course, this little scape is happy and the leucistic guppies are happy. Ooh, I could put some water in there, maybe a little top off. And then my plant quarantine tank is a plant quarantine tank. There's a wild caught epistogramma in there, Aruba lineata, hiding out in there somewhere. But I should do something with that tank, huh? What do you guys think I should do with that tank? If you guys are still watching this video, please let me know in the comments below. What do you think I should do in this tank? What kind of scape? What kind of biotope? What kind of a species? You guys know I like kind of more of a species tank. What should I put in this tank? Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you guys, if any of you out there are breeding Tetras, I'd love to know your experiences in the comments below as well. Let me know what you guys are going through. I'm really just getting into Tetras and, you know, to these more of these Tetra egg scattering Tetras and things like that. So I'm just really excited. I'm excited to share it with you guys. But thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you to all of you that like, comment, and share all of my content. Thank you to all of my Patreons on there, all of my supporters, everyone. I just appreciate everything. And remember, guys, keep your tanks clean, your fish fed, and have fun.